Today, we'll focus just on the HDB resale market. We'll look through the Asian financial crisis, the SARS episode, global financial crisis. Let's look at actually what happened in the HDB resale market during that time. Hey guys, my name is Michael Cho from UrbanZoom. Welcome to another episode of Data Stories. Today is 8 April 2020, so the second day of circuit break in Singapore. And I thought since I'm gonna be stuck at home, you know, probably for the next month, I probably should use my time to maybe record a video just like this one, hopefully once a day, where I'll be pouring through some data or some numbers and hopefully give you some stories that we can get from those numbers. I'm a geek, you know, I love this stuff, but if you are kind of like me, you like to look at numbers and the stories that you can get from the numbers, definitely consider subscribing. Or if you have a burning question about anything about Singapore, right, doesn't have to be about property market, but if you have a question about Singapore that you think would be good to use numbers to take a look, definitely leave a comment and maybe I'll be able to pick up some numbers and do an episode on that as well. Yesterday, I did one video where I talked through the potential impact of COVID-19 on the private property market in Singapore. So if you're interested in that, go watch that one. Today, it's kind of a follow-up to that, except that we'll focus just on the HDB resale market. So let's dive right in. So this is the HDB market price and as well as the monthly volume from all the way from 1990 to just last month, like March 2020. Obviously, it spans, I don't know how many, this is I think three decades. We're not gonna just go through 1 year by 1 year, and what we're gonna do is just look through specific time in the past, specifically during the Asian financial crisis period, the SARS episode, as well as the global financial crisis period. And hopefully by looking at what happened during that period, that can give us some idea of what might come in the next couple of months or quarters, maybe a year. So let's just start with Asian financial crisis. The whole thing started in, I think really on 2nd July, 1997, when the Thailand government actually have to float the Thai baht. It used to be pegged against the US dollar because they couldn't support it anymore with their foreign reserve and all that. So that set on a whole chain of lock-on effect. So a lot of Asian economies are affected, including Singapore. So things were really bad back then. But let's look at actually what happened in the HDB resale market during that time. Here, I've plotted the chart from July 1997, I think all the way to March 2020. So about 2.5 years since then. I've actually kind of based the top chart here is actually the price, the median price on the monthly basis of HDB. Actually rebase it as 100%, so you guys can quite clearly see the percentage drop. But let's just talk about the price first. So you know, if you mark it from July 1997, definitely you see a downward trend, a pretty significant price drop. In fact, it really started bottom up in January 1999, so a full year and a half, I would say, after the onset of this whole Asian financial crisis. So the median price, monthly median price, have actually dropped by something like 25%, so really quite a big drop. In terms of transaction volume, it did kind of tailor down a little bit. I mean, it was close to 3,000 monthly transactions, and then by the time it got to end of 1997, things have dropped closer to 2,000, but it never really dropped beyond that, right? So it actually went back up quite significantly. In fact, it jumped to close to 4,000 by the mid of 1998. This is happening while the prices are dropping, meaning the prices are actually being supported by a very healthy volume of transaction, right? You can see here the number of transactions, in fact, keep increasing. So actually, in terms of volume of transaction, it was a very healthy rebound. In fact, it doubled all the way to almost 6,000, right, about 2 years on. But having said that, the prices did drop. Actually, you kind of have to look at the 1 or 2 years before that. I would argue that the years before the Asian financial crisis, there was a real bubble in the property market in Singapore, in HDB as well. I mean, not just the private property sector. So it was kind of an adjustment, you know, that is needed. So in a way, this price drop is, to me, the market saying that, hey, actually the drop makes sense. And therefore you see actually very healthy volume supporting this price drop. It's pretty significant, like I said, 25%. What happened was towards the end of 1999, prices start to stabilize and in fact increase slightly, but you see that the transaction has dropped back to, you know, around the 2,000 to 3,000 monthly range. So that's what we saw in Asian financial crisis, a pretty steep drop in prices, and in fact it did not fully recover. I mean, 2 years in, this is still more than 10% below what was back in July 1997. So that's Asian financial crisis. Now SARS, if you look at these charts here, it's almost like a non-event. I mean, if I just show you this chart, you wouldn't even know that something bad has happened to the economy. And really SARS, you know, what we saw yesterday in the private property sector, it was almost a non-event, right? So I think what happened was I chose to plot this chart from February 2003. I think that's when the first reported case in Hong Kong, and then I think subsequently in March, that's when we had our first case here in Singapore. But frankly, within 2 or 3 months later, I think by then the WHO has already lifted Singapore from its infected country list. So it was a very, very short-lived kind of health crisis. But really, if you look at the number of transactions as well as the price, you wouldn't notice, right? People are still transacting. Very healthy volume, in fact, you know, still above the 2,000 range consistently. The prices have never really moved, right? In fact, you can argue that it went up a little bit over the course of the following 1 year. So not much to see here during the SARS period. Now, global financial crisis. I started plotting this chart from March 2008, and that's when Bear Stearn, it was forced into a fire sale. And I think they were sold to JP Morgan. Obviously, Bear Stearn was a big name on Wall Street. You know, everyone started to stand up. Something like this could happen. And since then, it's just months and months of very, very bad news, with the really bad one being Lehman Brothers, basically bankruptcy. So, which happened actually on the end of third quarter, September, October, something like that, in 2008. If you look at, again, the number of transactions as well as the prices here, right, this is for a HDB resale market. Unlike in the private property market, which is what we saw yesterday, if you want to take a look, you can go to the previous episode. We actually did not see that kind of drop as we saw in the private sector. The HDB resale sector was actually very resilient. I was a little bit surprised because I bought my home around this time. I thought I got an okay price, not too bad. But turn out, actually, if you look at the median price per square foot monthly basis, you know, in fact, the price did not really drop. In fact, it kind of increased pretty steadily. And in fact, from early 2009 onwards, there's really a pretty healthy increase. In fact, by the end of 2009, right, compared to say March of 2008, right, after 1 year and 9 months, right, you actually see the median price have actually increased 20%. So it's actually a non-trivial jump, actually. And in fact, if you look at the transaction volume as well, you know, it never really dropped. I mean, in this period, the end of year and the start of the year, usually that's when transaction goes down a little bit because of, you know, holiday period and then followed by Chinese New Year. But you really see the volume start picking up, in fact, surpassing 3,000 towards the end of October 2009. If you look at the past, I think these three episodes, right, really only Asian financial crisis where you see a pretty significant drop, like 25%, right, that's actually very, very painful for those people who bought at the peak. But it was accompanied by very, very strong recovery in transaction volume. And like I said just now, it could possibly because there was a real asset bubble. Whereas for SARS, a non-event, basically, GFC as well, actually, you know, the prices didn't really drop. In fact, it increased, as well as the transaction volume were pretty stable. In fact, again, it actually increased a fair bit 1 year into the crisis. The question is, right now, 2020, today, April 8th. So if you look at the first 3 months of the year, so I plotted this from January of this year. I think our first reported case in Singapore was on the 23rd, and it's around the same time that actually Wuhan in China, they have a lockdown, which is when the whole world, or at least the Asian countries, everyone set up, right, and say, oh, you know, something is serious going on in China. But frankly, I mean, if you look at the volume here, I mean, that there's a drop in February, which is quite typical. But then March, you know, you see a healthy return back to, in terms of volume, right? I mean, you're still talking about close to 2,000 transactions per month. And if you look at the prices, I mean, the prices are basically very stable, very stagnant, in fact. The question is, what will happen next? So obviously, because of this circuit break, you know, all the measures in place, effectively, there cannot be any more home viewing of the homes. And in my mind, if you don't have viewings, basically, there won't be transactions. Because of that, I think the transaction volume will likely drop literally to very, very close to zero over at least certainly the next 1-2 months until whenever these measures are lifted. You know, obviously for the first week of April, we'll still see the first week of April, that kind of number. But for the next 3 to 4 weeks, you know, when we are locked down, I highly doubt there's going to be any real transactions. The question is, how long will this last? Even if the measures are being lifted, how well will the economy pick up? Will people actually immediately go for viewings again? I suspect there will be quite a gradual return back to normalcy. Slow and gradual, yeah. You know, some people are, I think I mentioned in the previous episode, quite a lot of people are really banging their hope on a vaccine that can really cure the disease, so-called, and the sooner the better, right? But my own personal opinion as of now is that is actually a hard thing to wish for. I don't see it coming anytime within the next 2 years. It's quite hard to, I'm not an expert at all, but from what I know, it's not that easy to get a vaccine out, and especially, you know, a vaccine without any of the negative side effects. And then you also need it at scale and at relatively low cost so the whole world can have this vaccine, right? You don't want just rich countries having this vaccine, because for the whole world to get back to normal, the whole world need to travel, the whole world need to interact. You can't just have to reach, have the disease, because this disease doesn't care whether you're rich or poor, right? Once you get it, you get it. For that to happen, I think it's gonna be quite long. I actually think that the path towards normalcy in terms of like economic activity would be maybe testing at scale, which is very, very cheap as well. So think of it almost like picking up a thermometer from Watson, and then, you know, but this thermometer is something that you use on a daily basis to check whether you are COVID-19 positive, right? So if we can get testing kits, right, to be readily available at scale at very, very low cost, such that you can almost do it daily and DIY, right, do it yourself, then I think that will really drastically remove a lot of the fear, you know, when you meet someone in a meeting or even your family, family member, right? You have no idea whether the fella right next to you is positive, right? And he also don't know. But with testing, we can solve all that. And I think that is probably a much more realistic thing to happen. Vaccine to me is a huge, huge, huge bonus, obviously. If that can work, I don't know. We'll see. I mean, hopefully we get there. But in any case, I mean, if you look back at some of these numbers for the HDB market, you can see that the HDB resale market is very resilient, typically, except that when it's really have a bubble, which is kind of what happened in Asian financial crisis. Through the global financial crisis and even today, I mean, I would say that the HDB prices over the last 5-6 years has been very kept in check, you know, so we don't have a bubble situation. A lot of these measures from the government, actually, I don't think any of the HDB homeowners are really over leveraged, pretty safe, right? So in that sense, I think once things get back into normalcy, transaction will start to pick up again, but we won't see any dip in prices. I'll be quite surprised if prices drop. And not to mention now we are in a very, very low interest rate environment. So for people who actually choose to borrow from the bank, in fact, you know, some do, besides borrowing from HDB. So, and that might actually, in a way, move asset prices, including HDB prices, up. So let's see what will happen. Like I said just now earlier on, I'm gonna do this kind of video on a daily basis. So the episode for tomorrow, I'll probably switch back to private property market. And I do want to dig into a little bit further the difference between resale and new sale. In the market right now, there's some people who are saying that, oh, you know, new launches prices are going a little bit too steep, right, compared to resale prices. So I just wanna look through some of the numbers and discover for ourselves how true is that. If you're interested in this kind of thing, you know, definitely subscribe. And if you have a question for me, it doesn't necessarily have to be about real estate property. It could be about anything about Singapore, right? If you have a question and you think that by using numbers can give you an answer to that, you know, leave a comment. I'll try to get back to you, maybe with an answer question in a future episode. Anyway, in the meantime, stay safe and I'll see you in the next one.